When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on a cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like this. Worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come. And I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. To rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. To grace, how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Can we please bow down our head for prayers? Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us into another Sabbath. Every Sabbath that comes is a much needed rest, not only physically, but also spiritually. Thank you for the past week, for the many blessings and provisions you have brought to us. And as we gather together today through Zoom, please bless that there will be no technical issues that will hinder the sharing of your words. Let the contents of this program encourage, uplift, and testify to your goodness and love. Let the Holy Spirit guide the discussions of the Sabbath school lesson. We know your words holds truth. It is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword. Open our eyes and our hearts that we will receive understanding and respond to this new knowledge accordingly. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. In Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
The Southeast Hospital, located on the plains of Villahermosa, is one of three Adventist hospitals in Mexico. It sits in a prime location where Adventists have a chance to interact with the needy community. The people of this region suffer from health problems like diabetes, dengue fever, and obesity, and this hospital serves as a refuge for the sick and afflicted. Medical work began here in 1959 when missionaries set up a small clinic to provide basic health care to those in need. Doctors constantly volunteered time to serve the people. Materials such as syringes, needles, and medicine were donated by the city's pharmacies. As people began to rely on the Adventist missionaries' medical care, the clinic expanded to become one of the most reputable hospitals in the region, ministering to the needs of a surrounding population of more than 2 million people. The Southeast Hospital operates with more than 30 beds and 200 employees, and has a laboratory, an emergency room, a blood bank, and an intensive care unit. On average, the hospital staff sees 11,000 people every year. Many who arrive here expect physical healing, but they receive much more as the staff takes this opportunity to share Jesus's love in action.
El propósito es saber en realidad cómo está la persona.
Our purpose is to evaluate each person, not only the physical and emotional aspects, but also spiritual. Many of our patients tell us, "Oh, I'm not so good, but thanks to God, I can still walk." Others do not mention God at all. This helps us see where people are and know how we can help them. When they leave here, they can bear in mind that God is with them, that they have hope, and that they come out relieved, not only physically, but also spiritually, by God's word.
In Adventist hospitals around the world, spiritual care is an important component toward physical and mental recovery. At the age of 15, Michelle arrived at the hospital after hitting her head when she fell from a horse. It was a life and death situation. Dolly, her mother, prepared for the worst. Fortunately, Michelle received holistic care as the medical staff healed and comforted her.
People would come to me and say that God was with me and that they were praying for us. This is the first place I have seen this level of attention in dealing with people. Everyone is very kind. I realized here that the staff works for God and not for people. I had already heard that, but now I experienced it.
It was a tough time. For weeks, Michelle was hospitalized. So Pastor Eric, the hospital chaplain, would visit them to talk and pray. More than 500 people were touched by Michelle's situation, and they formed a prayer chain. As they prayed, little by little, Michelle's life was impacted by the prayers of the doctors and nurses. This closeness spoke deeply to Michelle's and Dolly's hearts. As a result, today they testify about the power of prayer.
I pray, Lord, my trust is in you, and I am yours. We will overcome. This mountain will be moved, and there will be no permanent damage.
In an inexplicable way, Michelle's condition stabilized, and she finally recovered. In medical institutions like Southeast Hospital, people are reached with health, healing, and hope. Just as Jesus healed the whole person, today faithful medical missionaries do the same through dedicated, God-centered care. The Southeast Hospital needs to expand to make room for more patients and to offer more treatment options. There is also a desire to build an urban center of influence in Villa Hermosa. This center will offer a place for the entire community to receive medical care and health training. Please pray for the hospital, the staff, and future plans. They face many challenges while operating in this small, outdated space. And also remember to pray for the patients whose lives will be touched by the hospital staff. Thank you for your support of Adventist medical mission work.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath to all of you. Shall we bow down our head for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we humbly come to your throne of grace this morning to praise and worship you. You are our Creator and created us in your image and in your likeness. We submit all of our nature to you. Please quicken our conscience with your holiness. Nourish our mind with your truth. Purify our imagination with your beauty. Open our hearts with your love. We surrender our will to your purpose. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to redeem us and restore your lost image in us. I pray for those who are celebrating their birthdays, baptism, and wedding anniversaries this week. May you continually grant them good health, protection, material, and spiritual blessings. For the husband and wives, may you strengthen their marital relationship and grow stronger as days pass by. As we review and study our lesson this morning, please educate our hearts as we invite your Holy Spirit to fill our lives. May all the glory and honor be yours now and forever. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Mm-hmm.
Okay, group two, you can now start, and we'll put everyone in the breakout rooms. Thank you.
So, good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
So, are we ready to start?
Ready.
Okay, I couldn't see all in the screen, so I don't know who is participating in our lesson discussion. So I think we should start with our lesson with a prayer.
We already pray.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay then. So our lesson this Sabbath is about education and redemption. So, and our memory verse can be found in 2 Timothy 3, verse 16. So it says here that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, correction, for instruction in righteousness. So it's just saying that all scripture is inspired of God. The Spirit of God not only inspired those who wrote it, but continually inspire or divinely assist those that read it with earnest prayer. Hence, it is so profitable for doctrine, for instruction of the ignorant, for the reproof or conviction of them that are in error or sin, for the correction or amendment of whatever is wrong, and for instructing or training up the children of God in all righteousness. So, if all scripture is profitable, meaning useful, then no part of the scripture is worthless. So, it is comparable to human body, like the body of church. All part has its function and is useful place. No part of it can be removed without suffering a sensible loss. So I would say it is parallel to Matthew 5 verse 18, which says, "For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or stroke shall pass from the law until all is accomplished." It just means that the Old Testament or the scripture is completely trustworthy, even to the smallest detail. Nothing can be removed from it. So, our lesson is about education and redemption. How will you define education? Can somebody define it for us? Brother Amado, what is redemption? Education.
Probably the gathering of all the knowledge that we can find about, you know. So education is it's a long process. It's not a single day, because as a human we never stop learning. And in the moment that I think that I already know everything, I'm in trouble. You know, so we must keep open to continue learning. And that one is in all areas, of course, the regular learning and the what is and especially in spiritual matters. So it's a process of receiving or giving systematic instruction, especially at the school or university. That is the definition that the dictionary has. So it's a process of receiving information.
Yeah. So education is just like the act or process of imparting or acquiring particular knowledge or skills.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how about the redemption? It's very...
Sister Annabelle has the hand there, brother.
Yeah, Sister Annabelle.
Yeah, I would like to go back to the meaning of education. In our lesson, education, the principle of education is to grow us closer to God. Unfortunately, nowadays in our schools, and majority of the schools, we study in schools where there is a little emphasis on God or not at all, unless you are in a Christian school. So what's happening is after you attain your education, you have your diploma, you had your master's, so the picture of God is totally not there at all. And people will learn, when they learn that much, that high, they disregard God, and they feel that, oh, I don't need God anymore.
Okay. Can I also add a little bit, Kuya? This one I quoted from Ellen G. White, Education. It says that true education has a higher aim. True education means more than a pursuit of a certain course or study, but it means more than a preparation for the life that is now. It has to do with the whole being and the whole period of existence possible to man, which is eternity. And so it is a harmonious development of the physical, mental, and spiritual powers, because it prepares the student for the joy of the service in this world and for the higher joy of service in the world to come. Mm-hmm. So, which is a very nice, it encompasses not just what is now and also our future beyond beyond this life.
Yeah. Anything else? So, is it clear to everybody? Yes, brother and mother.
So, having said that, based on the definition that Sister Amy just read, whatever humanistic education we receive in the university or so, that is partial education. That is, even though it's part of the education, it's not the whole picture, because like Sister Navel says, God is put it aside. The devil has put himself in the university or so, and many people think that they, when they got the PhDs or masters or whatever there, they are higher than any other people. They even believe that they are like gods or so, but it's not true. That is the mentality that the devil is putting in the regular. And I'm talking about those people that are very smart or whatever, that they have many titles. Doesn't matter how many titles we have and how much education, knowledge, or books we have, if we don't see beyond this world, that is still partial education.
Yeah.
Okay, so is that clear to everybody?
Yeah.
Let's go on. This time, what is redemption?
Redemption is the process of, process. It's the act that, to buy us back, Redemption is something that it was the property or so, and for whatever case we were lost, and in the spiritual realm is you and me, the devil practically snatched us out of the hand of our Lord, our Creator, and Jesus paid the price. So we are sometimes we listen or we heard from other preachers, we have been by not only we have belongs to Jesus, not only by creation, but by redemption as well. Double, but, and that is the price how much the Lord loves you and me.
Any addition to that?
It is an action of saving or being saved from sin, error, or evil. So as I understand, Jesus is our Redeemer. He will be the one to restore us from fallen human being to be an his image, back to his image of God.
Redemption. Yeah. What I get is in theology, it means deliverance from sin. Mm-hmm. It is an act of God's grace by which he rescues or restores his people.
Yes.
Okay, then, as we proceed with our discussion, let's figure out what is the connection between education and redemption. So, I would like to read from Genesis 1, verse 26. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. What does it mean to be made in the image of God?
I will answer that, Kuya. To be in the image of God, it means we are children of, I have some notes here. So it says like, to be in the image of God, we are children of God and part of his family. According to Ellen G. White, when Adam came from the Creator's hand, he bore his physical, mental, and spiritual nature, a likeness to his maker. So what are the attributes that Adam has that's like same with God? So God is creator and God is the ultimate creator. And so he also gave this ability to Adam. And it just goes beyond like having children, because we know that man has is procreating, right? So, but then this ability, this creative ability is more than that. It's also like how man knows how wants to create, like, you know, in the field of science, man is creating, like, you know, engineering, buildings, infrastructure. So those are creative abilities of man, and God enjoys it, and man as well finds fulfillment in being creative. The other attribute that God, that man has in the likeness of God is rulership. When God told man, fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth, God is the supreme ruler over all his creation, and God has delegated to man limited rulership to rule over the earth and over the animals on the earth. Another attribute is that personality, God created man with personality. So that's why man is an intellectual being, and we're so separate from like the animals. The animals, they have like, you know, they have instincts. But man is able to think both concrete and abstract. He's able to think about specific things and general things. He has ideas. And animals have limited intellect that they can only learn by experience and act in accordance with the instinct that God has given them. And also, man has emotions. Man is able to feel emotion, and he has developed an emotional capacity, and only man has complex emotion like sadness, joy, and fulfillment. And he also created man with free will, and man is able to talk and communicate. And only man also has the is able of all the creation, man is the only one who is able to discern morally right or wrong. So all these abilities, all these attributes, like, you know, it really places man only a little lower than the angels. And it's such an awe-inspiring to be given this place, to be an image of God, to be in the image of God. But it also comes with responsibility. We know that already. But then at the same time, we ask the question, why did God want us to be created in his image and likeness? What is the essence of God then? Why he wants us to be in this way? So I think because God is really relational, he wants to have a relation with us, and he also wants us to have a relation with others. And we know that the essence of God is love. So he wants to, that's why he opens our, as one of the greatest expression of his image in us is we are able to communicate with him like parent and child, or a student, a teacher and student. So we have this like meeting of mind, one of divine and one of human. And it's like, you know, he is there and we are here, but he opened up like this opportunity for us to communicate with him. I don't know if we really deserve to be in that position, but because we are children of God, so that's why he gave us this opportunity to be able to communicate with him. But the greatest expression of his image in us is if we reflect his character, which is love, because God is in all essence his love. All his other attributes has to be to align with being love. It has to align with love. He cannot have any attribute that doesn't, like, you know, align with love. And so we also reflect this image when we ourselves are also reflecting love to him and to others.
Yeah, so it's just like it refers to immortal part of humanity, the attributes given to humankind. Any other additional comment on this or question?
I just want to comment, brother, regarding what is the image men are made of the image of God. I thought before that God is that you and me will look like God, and in many sense it is like that. You can correct me, and I don't believe nobody has seen God before. That's what the Bible said. But I imagine that God has hands, has a face or so. We cannot see him now, but for sure, the Bible promised that we're going to see him one day, you know. So, and I thought that it was like that. But not only is that one, all the attributes that Sister Ogyu just told us, that, yeah, those ones, they are the characteristics that it makes you and me, that we were made originally to that with those abilities, and God provide that one for us. So so made to the image of God is more than physically thing, but all the characteristics that he put in you and me, in order to think, to make inference and see what is right and wrong, like you said. Beautiful God, beautiful creator, that creator. And even with all these years of degradation of sin or so, man still can do decision for right or for wrong. And that is the process of education that we study, that the Holy Spirit help us to go, to rectify, you know, and to accept and say, you are going in the wrong path, you know, turn around and face directly to God. That is education. And that is the process of redemption or so. I liked really the bottom part what the part of Sunday says, that is part at the very bottom. It's the story of redemption. It's a story of education from creation to incarnation and from incarnation to re-creation. God is a teacher, and God is teaching us, you and me. Beautiful part, Aaron.
Yeah. I just have a question. I'm just wondering.
Brother, raising his hand, Kuya. Brother Dan wants to add something, Kuya.
Oh, okay. I couldn't see. Yeah, unmute. Yes, Brother Dan.
Regarding the image and likeness of God, there are some attributes God didn't give to human beings. Like we know that God is all-powerful, is omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent. Those attributes he never given to man. Mm-hmm. It is only Satan who wants to, though Satan said, Lucifer said that, I want to be like God. It is not the attributes of God, which is love, which is caring, that Satan wants. It is the
power.
It is the power who he wants to confess. So when he tempted Adam and Eve, that he said, you will be like God when you disobey him or when you take the fruit of good and evil. And eventually, we define our good and evil. You see, when we disobey God, we are look God in our own right. We define our own what is right. So if you look back on our present society, people define their own sex. Oh, I am not a real male. I am female. I am a he. So our society arrived in this situation because man wants to be God. We want to define our own right and our own wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, I keep moving because I couldn't remove the shadow on the reflection of my glass, on my eyeglass. Yeah, I couldn't see what is the problem. Okay, I'm just wondering.
Sister Carmen has lifted up her hand.
Oh yes, Sister Carmen.
Okay, so God created us in His likeness. He created female and male. So also He remember He promised to multiply. So the law of production. So God created us to reproduce. That's why we able to have our children. So that's also one of the likeness that God has given to, from His image to humanity. That's all.
Yes, Brother Amado.
Yeah, probably some addendum to what Sister Carmen is saying is that God is a sociable God. You know, God is not, it's not a boring or a, that he wants to be alone, you know. As a matter of fact, in the Trinity, you know, you know that is the Father, you know, and the Holy Spirit. Even though God is one, and like we've been studying the past, Pastor Macarae, that manifested in three persons or so, you know, and he gave those characteristics to you and me as humans. To procreate, you know, so and that is a blessing, definitely, you know, so God is a wonderful,
that's true.
Yeah, I just have this additional question. Why do you think God created the human in His image?
Okay.
Can somebody answer that?
The purpose of God to make us in His image is so that He can teach us and bring us up as His children and communicate with us until His image is fully reflected in us.
Okay. Okay. And also, if you would notice on Genesis 1 verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea. So it means dominion means to have power and authority to rule over something, such as kingdom. This was actually part of God's blessings on mankind. Adam and Eve were given dominion over the entire earth, meaning they were to rule and reign over it on behalf of God, who is the ultimate ruler and king. So to be made in the image of God in his likeness means that humans are like God and represent him as ruler over creation. So that is the purpose of God in making man in his image. So everything is clear now, I guess.
Yes, I think so.
We can proceed.
Jesus as teacher.
Yeah. It was said that God's image was marred by sin. That the sins cloud our belief about God's power, holiness, and love, causing us to doubt his goodness. What do you think are the indicators that mankind had drifted away from God's image?
Since man has sinned, he's certainly not like, not fully like God. I mean, like, you know, before when Adam came from the hands of God, his intelligence and his mental, physical were, like, you know, a lot higher than what we have right now. So in essence, like right now, we are not, our moral purity has degenerated so much that our sinful character certainly does not reflect God's character, his holiness anymore. So yeah. our intellect is corrupted. Our speech, we don't speak as we should anymore. So we do not act as we should anymore. And our will and our, like, decisions are not anymore, like, you know, as pure and morally and more with high moral standards. Mm-hmm. So which means that we have really been obscured from you know, the purity of God because of sin. This is the great divide that sin has created in us. We cannot anymore be more like, it takes a lot more effort for us to be able to show all these character of God to others. On a basis of self-assessment also, Kuya, we also know that we are drifting away from God when we do not think about God anymore. We become so absorbed with our worldly concerns, and we do not fear God anymore. We don't pray anymore. So that's how we also know that we are straying away from God.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's true. When we forget to pray, or when we forget to open the Bible, then that is an indicator that we are drifting away from God. Mm-hmm. So,
but the good news, Kuya, is that even if our image has been distorted, there is a way that we can be restored, and that's what this lesson is all about.
Yeah. Okay, so any comment? You can go ahead, go on. Okay, in our Monday lesson, the Bible uses many terms to describe Jesus. He is the Son of God, the Messiah, the Son of Man, the Savior, Redeemer. But people who knew him best during his ministry in Judea and Galilee, he was a teacher. They called him master or rabbi, which means teacher. Can someone please read to us Isaiah 11, verses 1 to 9?
Okay, I will read it. Yeah, I will read it.
Go ahead.
Okay. Isaiah 11, 1 to 9. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girded of his reins. And the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and she and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion, and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. And the cow and the bear shall feed, their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. 8. And the sucking child shall play on the hall of the ox, and the wean child shall put his hand on the cock twice. Then they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea.
Okay, thank you, Sister Carmen. So, from these scriptures, what does it reveal about the teaching role of Jesus?
So, we remember that Jesus was given a lot of titles and names. And those, remember, he lives here in the earth for more than 3.5 years. But most of them called Jesus as rabbi or a teacher.
Yeah.
So the role of teacher here is understandable, since the goal of all teachers is to better the lives of their students. That is also the purpose of our redemption from death and sin, to give us not only a better life, but also an eternal one. And also is mentioned here in Isaiah 11, 1 and 2, one of the messianic prophecies contains many educational terms, such as wisdom, understanding, counsel, knowledge. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, certainly contributed this qualities to the education of our soul. And also, if you study our lesson, it said that the whole passage concludes with this remarkable promise: the earth shall be filled of the knowledge of the Lord as the water covers the sea, in Isaiah 11:9. Perhaps it also was such teaching of scripture that inspired Ellen G. White in her book on education to note that the work of education and the work of redemption are one.
Yeah, thank you. So the role of a teacher is to bring change into our lives through education with the goal of making lives better.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, Brother Armando.
I was saying that I just learned something last night. I said the prophet Isaiah is the gospel prophet, because many of the messianic prophecies are so about Jesus, about the Messiah. He was the one. And what we just read now is one of them. You remember the other one that it says that a child is going to be born and it will be his name, a counselor, prince of peace or so. That is the other one. Isaiah 53 is another one. So many of those prophecies, they pointed directly to Jesus. And we can find, that in the New Testament that Jesus what I want to say is that many of the people in the time when Jesus was alive in that ministry of 3.5 years, they didn't want to call him what is Messiah per se. It was probably socially acceptable for whoever was saying to call him Rabbi, you know. That's the case of Nicodemus or so, you know. So that when he came at night or so. So it was politically incorrect, I think, in those days, you know, and quite threatening for themselves and for their circle of the people or so to call him Messiah openly, you know. So nobody called him Redeemer or Messiah. The name Jesus itself, it meant Jesus, what is he saves, you know. So, and that's the meaning of the name. But it was morally acceptable to call him Rabbi or teacher. But Jesus is not only that one. You know, Jesus with his teaching told them and taught them that there is a dimension further, you know, that he was not a simple teacher. He was the Messiah, that Messiah that the prophet Isaiah was pointing 650 years before, you know?
Yeah.
So that's part of the teaching process there.
Okay, let's go on. And John 3 verses 1-3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do the signs that you do unless God is with him. As a Pharisee, what was significant in how Nicodemus addressed Jesus alone that night?
Okay, I'll answer that question, Efren.
Yes, please.
So Nicodemus addressed Jesus as Rabbi, even saying he was a teacher sent from God. Which is written in John 3, 1-3, as you have read. Whenever we teach the word, declaring that we must be born again, we are also teachers sent from God. What a solemn message we have to deliver, but also a joyful one, since it brings us such hope and peace. And also in our quarterly said that Nicodemus further identified Jesus teaching gifts as coming from God because of the sign Jesus performed, his miracles, and insight into the meaning of life. Surely, teaching is a gift of God. It is commissioned by God. It was adopted by Jesus, and it's recognized by those who are taught as having divine authority. So it's so important to share God's news to others, because Jesus teaches us to be a teacher, and the words from the scriptures are taught us to share it to others, to learn about Jesus, our Redeemer.
Okay, thank you so much. Can we go on with our next lesson? Can somebody please read for us 2 Timothy 3, verses 14-17?
Yep, I'm going to read the verse. It says here in 2 Timothy 3, 14-17. This is actually the letter of Paul to Timothy. And he said, but you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from you have learned them. And that from childhood you have known the holy scriptures, which are to make you wise for salvation through faith which is in Jesus Christ. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. 17. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for the every good work.
Yeah, so the question is, what do this text teach us about the role of scripture in Christian education?
The role of education for the the Bible of the scripture for Christian education is that the scripture is a sacred writing, and it is authoritative for the Christians, for us. And as a matter of fact, the Christian education has a formative view of the scripture. We practice Bible reading, Bible study, preaching, worship, and these are all formative in nature, which is part of the education. And the scripture functions authoritative with authority for our faith and our practice. We use the Holy Scripture as our source of moral and our spiritual instruction. Mm-hmm. The goal and purpose of the Christian education is to teach our children or even adults about the world God created, how our faith is woven in this area of learning, and how to find the purpose and meaning through God's will for our life. So eventually, the purpose of Christian education is to restore the image of God, which is the redemptive purpose. So that's all for the my answer to your question.
Yeah, I just have a follow-up question.
Okay, go ahead.
Does all scripture in 2 Timothy 3 verse 16 includes both Old and the New Testament?
My understanding is that it does not include everything. The Bible during that time, the New Testament is still on the making. So what's the scripture? The scripture they are using was the Old Testament. And what is all about the Old Testament? The Old Testament is composed of the Pentateuch, the Torah, which is the first five books of Moses, and then the prophets, also from other writings like the Book of Ruth, the Psalms, and the Proverbs, part of Solomon's writing. So these are all used during the times. They call it the Holy Scripture. But at present, in our present time today, there are two Bibles we have. The Bible consists of the Old and New Testament. We have the Protestant Bible and the Catholic Bible. What differs between the two? During the time of the 500 or AD 70, the Christian Bible was being formed. The Septuagint was the common use by the Jews and the Jewish Christian, and the Christian adopted the Old Testament of the Christian Bible. However, around 100 AD, the Jewish rabbis revised their scripture and established an official canon of Judaism, which included a portion of the Greek Septuagint. The material excluded was a group of 15 late Jewish books written in the period of 170 up to 70 AD. They were not found in the Hebrew version of the Jewish scripture. So Christians did not follow the revision Judaism and continue to use the text of the Septuagint as the Old Testament. So what about the Protestant Bible? During the 1500s, the Protestant leaders gathered together and decided to organize the Old Testament material according to the official canon of that the Judaism rather than the Septuagint. They moved the Old Testament material, which is not a Jewish canon, and separate section, which is called the Apocrypha. So the Protestant Bible then included some material on either earlier Bible, but it was divided into two sections. During the time, the Old Testament has two sections, the Old Testament and the Apocrypha. Protestant Bible include Apocrypha until the mid-1800s, and the King James Version was originally published with Apocrypha. However, the Apocrypha was considered less important, and the Bible publisher eventually removed or dropped it from most Protestant edition of the Bible. The books of Apocrypha are also known as the deuterocanonical books. How about the Catholic Bible or the Orthodox Bible? So the Roman Catholic and the Orthodox churches did not follow what the Protestant edition did. They continue based their Old Testament on the Septuagint. The result of this version of the Bible had more Testament books compared to the Protestant Bible or version. So the Catholic Old Testament include the first and the second Maccabees, Baruch, Tobit, Judith, Wisdom of Solomon, Sarah, and additional to Esther and the story of Susanna and Bel and the dragon, which is included in Daniel. The Orthodox Old Testament include plus 1 and 2nd Esdras, Prayer of Manasseh, Psalm 151, and the 3rd Maccabees. So in our present time, Christian today say that the Apocrypha are works usually written of the unknown authorship or a doubtful in origin. So in general, the word Apocrypha came and meaning the false, spurious, and bad or heretical. So the biblical Apocrypha are set texts include in the Septuagint and the Latin Vulgate, but not in the Hebrew. While the Catholic tradition considers some of these texts as deuterocanonical, so Protestant consider them apocryphal. So during the present time, the Bible influenced the world history and shows no sign of abating and continue to. There are estimated about 5 billion copies of the Bible worldwide, and it is considered the best-selling books of all times. And in year 200 or 2000, it sells approximately 100 million of copies annually. So what I considered it that the inspired book of the Bible, which is the Old and the New Testament. Aside from this, there are also other claimed inspired writing in our modern time, which include, you know, the Muslims and the Islam, they consider Quran as the inspired writings. The Book of Mormons by the Jesus Christ of the Latter-day Saints. And we Adventists, we consider the writing of Ellen G. White as inspired, isn't it? So these are all the inspired writings. But among these, it's still the Holy Bible, which includes the Old and New Testament, that is the best used as an instruction for our spiritual and our moral guidance. So I think we are fortunate compared in the time of Paul, because they don't have the New Testament, which is include the writing of the gospel of Jesus' disciple, the Acts of Apostles, and other epistles, writing of Paul and Peter, which we get our doctrines on them.
Yeah, thank you so much, Brother Dan. Since we don't have much time, let's go on with our Wednesday lesson. King Solomon comes to our mind when we think of someone wise, but Bible record also mentioned women who were wise, like the story of a woman from Tekoa in 2 Samuel 14, verse 2, and Anna's testimony in Luke 2, verses 36 to 38. From our Wednesday lesson, what three things can be noted about wisdom in the Bible?
Yeah.
Yes, Sister Annabel.
So in our lesson, first I would, there are three things that we can be noted about wisdom in the Bible. But first I would like to give the meaning of wisdom. It says wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. And in our lesson, it says that the wise is from the word, the Greek word sophiso, which means the act of becoming wise. And there's a saying, the more you read, the wiser you become. So in this lesson, there are three things. One, wisdom, it begins with God. In Proverbs 1:7, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. So one, it begins with God. The fear here, it doesn't mean that we should be afraid, or we should be despair, or we are in fright. But in here, it points that the fear is for respect, reverence.
Yeah.
So certainly there are many intelligent individuals who do not follow God. So in this statement seems contradictory, but the contention here is that it's not that one cannot have knowledge apart from God. Instead, it implies that knowledge is out of place apart from God. And then second, it is important to get wisdom when you are young. In Ecclesiastes 12:1, it says, remember now your creator in the days of your youth. And in Proverbs 22:6, our favorite verse, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. So it is really from our last week lesson, the role of parents is really important in teaching our children. And there is a Danish proverb that says, what youth learns, age does not forget. And number three, it's available to all of us. It's available to all of us through prayer. In James 1:5, it says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all liberally. So in this context, James is speaking of wisdom for a particular moment. This is a reference to those times when we don't know what to do, what the best choice, which way we should go, how do we decide between two different paths. Those who truly trust God will ask him for wisdom. Asking God for wisdom is evidence that we trust him.
Okay, thank you so much, Sister Annabel. But I just have a follow-up question. Besides asking for wisdom in prayer, what is needed for us to be wise?
In James, there is a text. I want to read James 1:6. There is a text in the Bible that says, here, James 1:6. But let him ask in faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. So whenever we ask God for wisdom, he promised that he will give us. So we have to ask, but we have to ask in faith. There is the condition. We have to ask in faith. And the condition is no doubt.
Yes.
That's the... That's the advice that is given to us.
Yeah.
Another verse in Mark 11:24, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours.
Yeah. Thank you so much. That's very clear. So, okay, let's go on. During the ministry of Jesus in Judea and Galilee, his students of or disciple was with him for 3.5 years, approximately the amount of time needed for a secondary or college education. At the completion of either period, students are often considered ready to manage on their own. But Jesus, knowing his students, he provided them with continuing education, but this time under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. The question is, in 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 to 16, what is Paul saying that is so important in the context of education?
I want to comment on that.
Yes, brother.
Because the verse are so there are 16 verses or so. Paul basically saying that when he came to the Greeks, that's the Corinthians, he put the doctrine of Jesus in the most simplest way. And that's one of the characteristics of Paul as a teacher, inspired by the Holy Spirit, obviously, you know. So, and he says, I didn't came with fancy words or so, but a simple. I preach Jesus and him crucified. To talk to Jesus, to the Greeks, about crucifixion. As a matter of fact, I was reading in the commentary said that the Greek didn't want to hear much about crucifixion, but it was a disgusting issue that for them or so. But Paul teach plainly in that way, you know. So and at the very end, when we continue reading in 1 Corinthians, it says there is no clever wisdom, only the gospel proclamation. You know, we have. At the very end, it says we can understand that these teachings or so because we have the mind of Christ. Wow, when you and me, we have the mind of Christ, we have access to practically all the amount of wisdom that it comes from God. You know, obviously, like we just discussed in the previous issue with Sister Annabel, we must have an act on faith, you know, and no doubt. And it says, when we have the mind of Christ, we are spirit-filled Christians. We have access to Him and any amount of learning and understanding that will be needed to know the path of righteousness. You know? So when we have, then, like the same way for you and me, we as teachers are trying to convey information to one each other. We have to use simple words, you know, and being inspired by the Holy Spirit, we have access to the mind of Christ, and if we have access there, oh my, everything is the real education will be for you and me. Remember that we are in the process of knowledge to be recreated, and we are going back to the Garden of Eden. That is the real purpose of education, and that is the education that Jesus wants you and me to have. So nowadays, we have the Paracletos, the Holy Spirit, helping you and me to not only to learn the science of salvation, but to transfer that knowledge with simple words to the other people.
Yeah. Anybody who wants to add something or any comments? Okay, I would like to add something with that. If you would notice in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, mm-hmm. It just means that the wisdom which was revealed in the gospel was not known to all. No man had understood it. The wisdom or plan of redemption surpassed the wisdom and comprehension of man. Mm-hmm. But in verse 10, you will follow it. Now we have received the Spirit of God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. Mm-hmm. So the Spirit is given to us in order that we might fully understand the favors which God has conferred on us in the gospel. Mm-hmm. By grace, we receive the blessing of redemption. Redemption, which include the pardon of sin, justification, sanctification, the divine favor and protection, and the hope of eternal life. Mm. So, being born of Spirit, therefore, we are capable of knowing His mind and receiving the teaching of His Spirit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, any other addition or comment?
Yeah, I would like to add one line. I believe that true education has a redemptive purpose. If it has no redemptive purpose, you cannot call it a true education.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that the Holy Spirit, the Bible doesn't tell us that the Holy Spirit is a teacher, but it teaches us in reality the real meaning of salvation and redemption or so, you know. So only when you and me, we are guided by the Holy Spirit, then we're going to get into the mind of Jesus. And, you know, and if we have the mind of Jesus, we have access to all the knowledge the universe yes. has, you know, and we can focus in the right way back to our Lord and our Savior, you know. So the real education is the process of redemption of my soul and the soul of all the human beings. That's the beauty of the real, real education. Yeah.
Thank you so much. So just like what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:16, we have the mind of Christ. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. So to end up our lesson, what then is the connection between education and redemption? Anybody who want to comment on that?
Yeah.
Yes, Sister Annabel.
We already mentioned, true education brings us closer to God. Because there are different educated people, they don't believe God. And they are learning apart from acknowledging God. But the thing is, as we have said in our lesson, if we don't, our education is useless, or probably useless is a very harsh word. Our education is, it is not, it is, if it is from apart from God, so it is not the true education. So true education brings us closer to God, and it restores the image of God in us.
Yeah. And so just like Timothy's advice, we must utilize all the scripture, all the New Testament prophets alike, for it would help us understand the plan of redemption. Mm-hmm. Although we can earn redemption from sin and death, there is much we can learn about the subject by studying the Word of God. The best educational tool we have in acquiring the knowledge of what is involved in the redemption of mankind. Okay, I think we already finished our lesson.
Thank you, class two.
I would like to request Brother Amado for a closing prayer.
Dear Father, thank you for this beautiful lesson, Lord. Thank you for reminding us that the true education help us to not only focus on you, Lord, and that's the way it is. So any other kind of education, Lord, that is separate us from you, that is not true education. Probably it's partial education, Lord. But we want to have the mind of Christ. Holy Spirit, help us every single day to look toward our Redemptor, our Savior, Jesus Christ, Lord, and educate us every single day and put in practice, Lord, the wisdom that we are getting from it, Lord, in order to see the salvation that you have for each one of us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your Holy Bible. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone.
Happy Sabbath,
everyone. Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath.